You're watching Electrical Engineering Lectures channel. For more videos, please do like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for the latest notifications.
Hello everyone. In the previous lecture, we have discussed the concept of quadrature amplitude modulation along with its coherent detection. In this lecture, we will be discussing the concept of frequency shift keying. Frequency shift keying is basically the digital counterpart of frequency modulation. And the concept of frequency modulation is that you are going to change the frequency of the carrier in accordance with the amplitude of the message signal. The same concept applies here, but the only difference will be that in this case, we are in digital domain and we have a finite set of transmit symbols or bits. So the number of frequencies will also be finite. It means the frequency will not be changing in a continuous manner, but it will be changing in a discrete way or digital way. How this is happening? Let us consider that we have a binary stream, and for simplicity we start with m is equal to 2. Let's say the binary stream is 1 0 1, and the corresponding NRZ shape, or simply a pulse representation, is like this. That for 1 it is plus 1 and for 0 it is minus 1. So we only have two kinds of symbols, either it is plus 1 or it is minus 1. It means we are only going to change the frequency of the carrier and not the amplitude and not the phase. So it will simply mean that when a bit 1 arrives or a symbol plus 1 arrives, we will transmit a carrier with a particular frequency, let's say F1, and for the second bit, which is 0, or in terms of symbol it is minus 1, we will transmit the second carrier with frequency F2, right? So the time domain representation for this concept will be such that if this is the symbol period capital T, so for the first symbol period, since the transmit bit is 1, so we will transmit a carrier with a particular frequency, and inside this bit, frequency will not change because the amplitude is constant. You should keep in mind that the frequency is directly proportional to the amplitude of the message signal. So for a complete bit duration or symbol duration, here the amplitude is constant, so frequency will not change. But for the second bit, since the bit is now changed and correspondingly amplitude is changed, so now we will transmit another carrier having different frequency. Let's say it is higher than the previous one. This. So the frequency of the first carrier was F1 and frequency of the second carrier is F2. And the next, again, we have 1. So we will transmit the same carrier with frequency F1, which we transmitted earlier. So this procedure will be continued to generate the corresponding transmitted signal, right? So this is the main concept. Now you see, the most important point in case of FSK will be that how many frequencies will be required for transmission. So the answer to this question is very simple. The number of frequencies will be equal to the number of levels. It means number of levels is what? It is the value of m. In this particular case, m is equal to 2. So we only require 2 frequencies to be transmitted. If, for example, we say m is equal to 4, it means we need to transmit 4 frequencies, F1, F2, F3, and F4. Right? So it means the number of frequencies is directly equal to the number of levels or the value of m. Now, mathematically, the transmit pulse si of t will be given by this particular equation. And again, here you see the amplitude is not depending on the value of I. The only thing which is changing with I is omega I, which is the frequency. And furthermore, it can be written in a more explicit manner as this one, cos omega ct. It means there is a constant frequency, which is the carrier frequency, and it will change the frequency of the signal around the carrier frequency, right? If, for example, the message signal is 0, it doesn't mean that the frequency of the carrier will be 0. No, there will be a constant frequency, and the change in the frequency will be around that carrier frequency. So omega ct is the constant frequency, which will always be available for transmission. And the next part is I minus 1 into delta omega into t. So this I minus 1 is corresponding to the ith symbol, and delta omega is called the frequency deviation. How much increment will you give around the carrier frequency to generate a particular symbol? And that delta omega can be converted into delta F by simply dividing it by 2 pi. And we will show later on that this delta F, the frequency deviation in hertz, it must be equal to 1 over 2 capital T. This is the condition for orthogonality, which is used in frequency shift keying, that you have to select the number of frequencies in such a way that the separation between two frequencies, for example, for binary, we have F1 and F2. So the separation between F1 and F2 must be equal to 1 over 2 capital T. From this condition, you should note that how many basis functions we will require for transmission. It means we will require the number of basis functions also equal to capital M. And due to this reason, this FSK belongs to the category of multidimensional modulation, that we need to have more than two basis functions for transmission if definitely M is greater than 2. So generally speaking, Si of t can be written in the form of basis function by using this particular equation, summation j equal to 1 to capital M Aij psi j of t. And psi j of t is basically a cosine with changing frequency omega I of t. And what about the amplitudes? The amplitudes will be constant. The coefficients will be constant, but they are not non-zero for all the values of j. But they will be only non-zero for I is equal to j. It means we will have the signal vectors only along the principal axis of basis functions, as shown in this particular diagram. Just to explain this concept, let me open up this equation for m is equal to 3. So Si of t is equal to summation j equal to 1 to capital M Aij psi j of t for I equal to 1, 2 to capital M. So for m is equal to 3, the first equation comes out to be S1 of t equals A 1 1 psi 1 of t plus A 1 2 psi 2 of t plus A 1 3 psi 3 of t, because we need to have three basis functions. The second equation becomes S2 of t equals A 2 1 psi 1 of t plus A 2 2 psi 2 of t plus A 3 2 A23 psi 3 of t. And the third equation becomes S3 of t A31 psi 1 of t plus A32 psi 2 of t plus A33 psi 3 of t. And the condition is that Aij, it will be equal to a non-zero value, which is, let's say, E S square root, and it will be independent of the value of I, because all the constants will have the same magnitude. So it will be equal to E S square root for I is equal to j, and it will be zero for I not equal to j. It means which coefficients will be zero in these three equations? This will be zero, this will be zero, this is zero, this is zero, this is zero, and this is zero. So only the non-zero coefficients will be this one, this one, and this one, A11, A22, and A33, where I is equal to j, right? So now the value of A11 will be equal to A22, will be equal to A33, and they will be equal to ES square root by using this particular equation. It means we have three coefficients, and each of these coefficient will be multiplied with Psi1, Psi2, and Psi3 respectively, so that the constellation diagram, in this case, it will contain, number one, the point is that it will contain not two basis functions. Now it will contain three basis functions because we have m is equal to 3. So this is along the x-axis, one along the y-axis, and the third along the z-axis. And the constellation points, as I've told you, that each constellation point will be lying along the principal axis of the basis function. So this is the first one, this is the second one, and this is the third one, where this is equal to A11, A22 and A33, and all of these coefficients have the value of, or the length of these, or the magnitude of these coefficients will be ES. The same for here, same for this one, and same for this one. So this is only for case m is equal to 3. If you make m is equal to 4 and further higher, it means the number of dimensions will be increased and you cannot easily plot them by using this way. But the point of understanding is that the number of basis functions or the number of frequencies which must be orthogonal to each other, it will be equal to the value of m. And due to this reason, this frequency shift keying scheme is not much bandwidth efficient, because by increasing the value of m, you will require as many frequencies as the value of m, and this will definitely increase the bandwidth of the signal, right? So due to this reason, this is not a very bandwidth efficient scheme, but in terms of performance, this scheme is much better as compared to all the previous ones, because it is providing a very significantly apart decision regions due to the orthogonal basis functions. And each of the symbol is lying directly along the principal axis of the basis functions. As far as the detector is concerned, for FSK, it is again, we are talking about coherent detector, and the detection is relatively straightforward. Although it is not very simple, but the implementation is straightforward in terms of the overall block diagram, that you will require m basis functions, and simply you will perform correlation with each of these basis functions. The received data will come, R of t, and you will perform the correlation with each of the basis functions. And after performing the correlation, you see, this is the correlation. There are m branches, and in each branch, you are performing the correlation with each of the basis function. So after performing the correlation, you will be achieving m values of the sample data. And then in the detection, you will be comparing it with the threshold to detect the corresponding message signal, right? So this is all about the overall concept of frequency shift keying. Thank you for listening.
You're watching Electrical Engineering Lectures channel. For more videos, please do like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for the latest notifications.